Thank you. That Allen.
Why, thank you.
Thank you.
Check, check, 1, 2, check. Check, check, check. Can you hear me, Gene?
Looks spooky. I just want you to be like.
Good morning. Let's try. One day I will remember exactly how the mic is supposed to go, but until then, good morning. Welcome to Woodland Park Presbyterian Church on this first Sunday after Christmas and our hybrid format worship service. It's great to see all of you here and all of you on the screen. I'm the pastor. I'm through Reverend Joseph Sheeran. I'm one of the pastors here along with Reverend Stacy Imes, who is enjoying some much-needed vacation. And if you are joining us for the first time, or first time in a long time, in person or on Zoom, we're glad you're here. We hope you feel welcome, invited, and comfortable to participate as much or as little as feels right to you. Along those lines, we will be celebrating communion today, as we do every Sunday here at Woodland Park Presbyterian Church. If you are joining us remotely, this is your invitation and reminder to have something ready to eat and drink for that part of the service, something that feels right to you. Before we continue in our time of worship together, I'd like to share an announcement. That's our land acknowledgement. I'd like to acknowledge that Woodland Park Presbyterian Church and many of our homes are located on the unceded ancestral lands of the Duwamish and other peoples. The Duwamish are the first people of Seattle, and they are still here, continuing to honor and bring light to their heritage, who benefit every day from the theft of their land. And with that said, let us continue in our time of worship together. One of our traditions born out of the pandemic is using the ASL for peace. What's it? We're going to do a carol first? Oh! That's what I get. Let's have carol at crush time.
So, as we do traditionally now on this Sunday after Christmas, two of our times for singing hymns are going to be your requests for Christmas carols. It'll just be a big old improvised medley. We'll do a verse or two of each song. So if you want to pick out the hymnal right now and look at the section right at the beginning, it's hymns basically 1 through 70 or so, are the Advent, Christmas, and Epiphany hymns. And if there are any that you particularly love that you would like to sing together this morning, just holler it out and we'll add it to the list and we'll get to all of them by the end of the morning. And give me the number and the title if you don't mind. Five. One.
Did you get
number 9?
47 and 46.
48.
4.
All right, any others? Last call. 30. Thirty-six.
66.
66. How about the video people?
Say that one more time.
69.
69 it is. All right.
Do we have any in the chat?
Okay, if I hear no more going, gone, let's move on to passing of the peace.
Peace of Christ be with you. Can we, online community, can we hear each other?
Yeah. Hey, Marilyn, it's good to see you. Yes, so all of us in the sanctuary can hear you guys. We don't. Just online folks can talk to each other. There is a chat, but what's great about this is that we can see you and we can hear you, just like you can see and hear us.
Terrific, love it.
Yeah, and Marilyn, remind me, you were an intern here at the beginning of your ministry, right?
Well, I was a member there for years and years. I still consider this my home church. I went under care. And when I went to seminary, I was under care by the Woodland Park session and was well cared for by you folks, well nurtured and well loved all along I've always felt loved by this bunch and still hold so many of you dear to my heart as running buddies and I just love beloved friends. So and that now includes my husband Bob. For a while there we were being considered to be pastors at Woodland Park long time ago during one of your searches. But these days we're retired and happily and settled in Oakland, California, and well settled since we're both disabled and get around town, buzz all over Oakland in our me and my wheelchair, and Bob using because he doesn't walk so well anymore at 93, is using one of my old wheelchairs, and we buzz all over town. Love it. So I want to say hello to you folks.
Well, yeah, it's great to see you. And in the spirit of greeting, let's get back with our track. One of our traditions, Marilyn, that might be new to you, but I hope it's familiar to everyone else, is using the ASL sign for peace be with you, which looks like the peace be with you. So friends, the peace of Christ be with you all.
Peace be with you all, huh? That's easy.
Let's exchange signs of peace with our neighbors.
We need to teach this at our church, Bob.
That's good.
Peace be with you. Peace be with you.
Peace be with you.
Peace be with you.
Peace be with you.
Peace be with you. Peace be with you all.
Peace of Christ be with you all.
The holy day has come and gone. We've celebrated the coming of Emmanuel, God with us. We have feasted in joy with our loved ones. Now, at this time, when light begins to return to the world, why are you here? We have come still seeking Emmanuel, still longing for God with us, for God among us. Then let us sing together songs of joy, songs of hope, even songs of grief, remembering that God has come to be with us. We will sing and remember that God is here still.
All right, let's kick off our first carol sing moment here. We'll just start right at the top with number one. And then we'll just be going a few pages, so I'll holler as we go. But we'll do a verse of number one first. thy people free from our fears and sins. Release us, let us find our rest in thee. Now let's just flip to number two and do the more familiar melody that begins the same way. Come, thou long expected Jesus, born to set thy people free from our fears and sins. Release us, let us find our rest in thee. Israel's strength and consolation, hope of all. Flip over to number four. This one's a little chanty.
Creator of the stars of night, your people's everlasting light. O Christ, Redeemer of us all, we pray you hear us when.
And then, number five.
Let all mortal flesh keep silence, and with fear and trembling stand. Ponder nothing earthly minded, for with blessing in his hand, Christ our God to earth descendeth, our full homage to demand.
And now let's skip back to number 36. Verse 4.
What can I give him, poor as I am? If I were a shepherd, I would bring a lamb. If I were a wise man, I would do. Yet what can I give him? Give my heart.
And let's flip back to number 9.
That mourns in lowly exile.
verse 3. Oh, come desire of nations, bind all peoples in one heart and mind. Bid envy, strife, and discord cease.
Please join me in the prayer of confession. Holy One, source of all love, at this time when the years turn and light returns slowly to our world, help us to remember that you are still here. Heal us, loving Maker, in our hearts, in our world, of that which pulls us away from one another and drives us to disconnect so often, to seek distraction, to focus only on ourselves, and accept brokenness in our world. Renew our spirits with an active hope to seek and to be your people, and with love and resilience, claim our power together to seek and to be your light in this world.
As Creator, God made us and knows us fully. When we are honest about our true nature before God, our imperfection is part of our perfection in God's eyes. Friends, let us hear and believe the good news of the gospel. In God's grace, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God.
Please join me in the prayer for illumination. Holy One, open our ears and our hearts to your gospel so that with your help, we can live into the love to which we've been called. Amen. Scripture reading today is from Gospel of Mark, right from the beginning, chapter 1, verse 1. The beginning of the good news of Jesus Christ. As it is written in the prophet Isaiah, "See, I'm sending my messenger ahead of you, who will prepare your way. The voice of one crying out in the wilderness, 'Prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight.'" So John the Baptizer appeared in the wilderness, proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. And the whole Judean region and all the people of Jerusalem were going out to him and were baptized by him in the river Jordan, confessing their sins. Now John was clothed with camel's hair, with a leather belt around his waist, and he ate locusts and wild honey. He proclaimed, "The one who's more powerful than I is coming after me. I'm not worthy to stoop down and untie the strap of his sandals. I've baptized you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit." In those days, Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. And just as he was coming up out of the water, he saw the heavens torn apart and the Spirit descending like a dove upon him. And a voice came from the heavens, "You are my Son, the Beloved. With you I am well pleased." And the Spirit immediately drove him out into the wilderness. He was in the wilderness 40 days, tested by Satan, and he was with the wild beasts, and the angels waited on him. Now, after John was arrested, Jesus came to Galilee proclaiming the good news of God and saying, "The time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe in the good news." As Jesus passed along the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and his brother Andrew casting a net into the sea, for they were fishers. And Jesus said to them, "Follow me." "And I will make you fishers of people." And immediately they left their nets and followed him. As he went a little farther, he saw James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John, who were in their boat mending the nets. Immediately he called them, and they left their father Zebedee in the boat with the hired men and followed him. These are the stories of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. And now, J. Kyle has grown tired of preaching to the choir. And now he's going to preach to the masses.
Thank you, Finley. Will you pray with me? God, be with us and in us as we hear your stories for us this morning. May the words of our mouths and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Well, here we are. It's the seventh day of Christmas. All right, release the swans. Jesus is born, and we're right in the middle of celebrating his birth with 5 days of Christmas yet to come before Epiphany season begins. Oh, yeah. Yet, here we are, already hearing stories of a grown man, Jesus, already confronting the strange and difficult work that lies ahead. He doesn't even get to sleep in heavenly peace for a full week. But we know that Jesus can't stay laid in that manger. He's a man with a mission. But how did he get to where we see him in today's reading? A little background. We know that of the canonical Gospels, Mark is the oldest text. And there's evidence in all three of the other Gospels that they drew heavily on the stories that Mark told first. And the Gospel of Mark is famously, its undercurrent is really more like a riptide. It's an immediate text. It's an urgent text. The author of Mark tells his story not like a scholar or even a theologian, but more like your favorite uncle entertaining us around the campfire. It's action-packed and fast-paced. And within the first 20 verses alone, we meet John the Baptist, we meet Jesus, he gets baptized, he's gone for a while, and then he comes back and he's already calling disciples. The other three Gospels, each in its own distinct fashion, gives the stories of Jesus a little more room to breathe, some more table setting and world building. And there are a lot of stories in those other Gospels that aren't included in Mark, probably because Mark didn't even know them yet. They weren't widely known or spread stories. The Gospel of Mark begins where the story actively matters to the author and its audience in their time. But what about the child Jesus? We're going to spend some time this morning glancing through the stories of the young Jesus on his way to where we meet him today. The stories of those who witnessed and marveled at him. And I'm going to ask several of you to read little excerpts from the Gospels of Matthew and Luke so that we can try to get a fuller picture of how we get to where we are today and why it matters how we got there. So, even before the nativity story begins in earnest, we hear of Mary, early in pregnancy, making a solo trek to visit her older cousin Elizabeth. You remember Elizabeth from last week. Her husband Zechariah was literally struck speechless when he dared look askance at an angel who said that his wife was going to conceive and bear a child. But last week we skipped over the part where Mary goes to visit Elizabeth. May I have two volunteers, please? I'll get a microphone as well. Yeah. Who was my other? Thank you. Go ahead.
In those days, Mary set out and went with haste to a Judean town in the hill country, where she entered the house of Zechariah and greeted Elizabeth. When Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, the child leapt in her womb, and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit and exclaimed with a loud cry, "Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb. And why has this happened to me that the mother of my Lord comes to me? For as soon as I heard the sound of your greeting, the child in my womb leapt for joy. And blessed is she who believed that there would be a fulfillment of what was spoken to her by the Lord."
And Mary said, "My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior, for he has looked with favor on the lowliness of his servant. Surely, from now on, all generations will call me blessed, for the Mighty One has done great things for me, and holy is his name. His mercy is for those who fear him from generation to generation. He has shown strength with his arm. He has scattered the proud in the thoughts of their hearts. He has brought down the powerful from their thrones and lifted up the lowly. He has filled the hungry with good things and sent the rich away empty. He has helped his servant Israel in remembrance of his mercy, according to the promise he made to our ancestors, to Abraham and to his descendants forever." And Mary remained with her for about 3 months and then returned to her home.
Thank you. Joy, so powerful that unborn children leap in the womb. Two women, each living, mirroring miracles. So wondrous that they can't help but get together and start dreaming about what these children are going to be. And what do they dream their boys will be? Bold, generous anarchists for peace. And then, of course, John and Jesus are born. We've got those stories covered. So, on the heels of the birth, as we celebrated it last week, what happens next? Who would like to read next? Peggy?
After 8 days had passed, it was time to circumcise the child, and he was called Jesus, the name given by the angel before he was conceived in the womb. When the time came for their purification, according to the law of Moses, they brought him up to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord. As it is written in the law of the Lord, every firstborn male shall be designated as holy to the Lord. And they offered a sacrifice according to what is stated in the law of the Lord, a pair of turtle doves or two young pigeons.
So the prophets are being fulfilled, as is pointed out several times in the Nativity text. And now we pause to fulfill the law. An important reminder for us that Jesus was a Jewish man from beginning to end, who never advocated or called for the denial or the destruction of the Hebrew people or the Jewish faith. Meanwhile, at the ceremony of his naming, excuse me, and circumcision, we meet Simeon. Who would like to read for Simeon? Jane, I'll do it.
Mm-hmm. Now there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon. This man was righteous and devout, looking forward to the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Spirit rested on him. It had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not see death before he had seen the Lord's Messiah. Guided by the Spirit, Simeon came into the temple, and when the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him what was customary under the law, Simeon took him in his arms and praised God, saying, "Master, now you are dismissing your servant in peace according to your word. For my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the presence of all peoples, a light for revelation to the Gentiles and for glory to your people Israel." And the child's father and mother were amazed at what was being said about him. Then Simeon blessed them and said to his mother Mary, "This child is destined for the falling and the rising of many in Israel, and to be a sign how it will be opposed, so that the inner thoughts of many will be revealed, and a sword will pierce your own soul too."
There's that triumphal anarchy again. The falling and the rising of many in Israel. A sign that will be opposed so that the inner thoughts of many will be revealed. Oh, and by the way, Mary, a sword will pierce your own soul too. Now, while they're still in Jerusalem, we meet yet one more character. Who's next? Tom.
There was also a prophet, Anna, the daughter of Phanuel of the tribe of Asher. She was of great age, having lived with her husband for 7 years after her marriage, then as a widow to the age of 84. She never left the temple, but worshiped there with fasting and prayer night and day. At that moment, she came and began to praise God and to speak about the child to who were looking for the redemption of Jerusalem.
I like Anna. She's like an excitable great auntie. She just can't keep her mouth shut with the joy that this baby sparks in her. And she becomes a fire starter. It's worth noting how the story of Mary and Jesus bears a lot of resemblance to the Old Testament story of Samuel and his mother, Hannah. Now, Hannah, that's another miraculous conception. Hannah is the same name as Anna. Incidentally, a name shared by the mother of Mary herself. Women chosen by God for a purpose, charged with being the bearers of God's plan, and blessed with joy and grace for trusting and acting with confidence in that purpose. Now, moving forward, in our absolutely delightful pageant on Christmas Eve, we heard about the Magi who came to bring him gifts. We heard how they were warned in a dream by an angel not to return to Herod with news of the baby's whereabouts. But news travels, and Herod finds out and makes an edict that all male babies under the age of 2 should be put to death. But Joseph has also been warned by that same angel. And so now, Joseph and Mary and baby make yet another trip, this time to Egypt, where they will wait out the mortal threat. And this is where we make a major time jump in our stories. Several non-canonical gospels have a lot of stories about Jesus's early childhood, like the time when he was 5 and he made some birds out of clay and breathed life into them, or the time that his brother was bitten by a poisonous snake and Jesus healed him, or the time when they entered Egypt right after this story, when they set foot in Egypt, earthquakes happened, and all of the gods of Egypt fell to the ground shattered. There are even stories of an immature and vengeful child Jesus, a rampant murderer and threat bearer. But in our Gospels, in the canonical Gospels, we leap now to when he's about 12 years old. They've since moved back to Joseph's home in Nazareth. And I have two more volunteers, please.
Now every year his parents went to Jerusalem for the festival of Passover. And when he was 12 years old, they went up as usual for the festival. When the festival was ended and they started to return, the boy Jesus stayed behind in Jerusalem, but his parents did not know it. Assuming that he was in the group of travelers, they went a day's journey. Then they started to look for him among their relatives and friends. When they did not find him, they returned to Jerusalem to seek for him. After 3 days, they found him in the temple, sitting among the teachers, listening to them and asking them questions. And all who heard him were amazed at his understanding and his answers.
When his parents saw him, they were astonished. And his mother said to him, "Child, why have you treated us like this? Look, your father and I have been searching for you in great anxiety." And he said to them, "Why were you searching for me? Did you not know that I must be in my father's house?" But they did not understand what he said to them. Then he went down with them and came to Nazareth and was obedient to them. His mother treasured all these things in her heart, and Jesus increased in wisdom and in years and in divine and human favor.
And my folks thought I was precocious. The end of that passage is the transition from child Jesus to adult Jesus. So we just jump straight ahead again, ready to start ministry. One last favor to ask. If you read one of those pieces of scripture this morning, will you please stand where you are for a moment? Just take a look at this group here. I'd say a team of this size could probably get a lot done, don't you think? Go ahead and have a seat. Thank you. Thank you all for reading. Throughout the season of Advent, we looked at some of the subversive saints of Seattle and the communities that built them and supported them. The main thrust of this edition of Subversive Saints was to clearly point out the necessity of community, of sharing the load. None of the folks depicted in the art that we've seen this season would be who they are by their personal efforts alone. They are upheld and spurred on by the people who listened, the people who caught wind of something mysterious and new, something potentially life-changing, life-saving, and life-giving. Elizabeth and Zechariah, the innkeeper, the shepherds, the animals, the moil, Simeon, Anna, the Magi, the citizens of a small town in Egypt, Mary and Joseph's extended family, curious temple goers at the Passover festival, they too caught wind of something mysterious and new, something potentially life-changing and life-saving and life-giving. Just as with our modern saints, a community arose to bring a child to life. They listened and they responded. Some gave gifts of monetary value. Some gave gifts of expertise. Others gave gifts of enabling support. Still others gave the gift of hearing and spreading the message. All gave gifts of their time, and more importantly, of their spirit, their energy, They knew that the world was on the verge of a spectacular change, and they reacted proportionately. Not one of us can do the work set out for us by ourselves. Not even Jesus could do it alone. Not even God wanted to do it alone, for heaven's sake. God called on Mary and Joseph and Elizabeth and John and Anna and Simeon and. God asked for mere mortals to pitch in, to listen and answer, to dream of anarchy, to create an environment where their children could complete the work to which they were called, the work that they were born to do. Even in today's reading, we see Jesus acting on this. What's the first thing he does upon his baptism? Well, he kicks off for 40 days, but then he comes back, and the first thing he does is assemble a team who will go with him in ministry and help him do this strange and difficult work. And against all logic and reason, they drop what they're doing and go with him. The community of Christ's work is ever expanding, ever being called anew, ever drawing us to cast our nets for more. Not to increase the number of souls saved, but to increase the power of the good news and to nurture one another in the work of love and justice. What is it Mary says? To scatter the proud in the thoughts of their hearts, to bring down the powerful from their thrones and lift up the lowly, to fill the hungry with good things and send the rich away empty, to be together as one, the kingdom of God on earth. I don't know what the future of our community looks like. It's no news that we're in the midst of a number of significant transitions within and around our church alone. And our community, of course, reaches beyond these walls. To what end, we have yet to discern, but we know that we do not belong ensconced in brick and mortar, idly worshiping a God whose purpose for us is so much more. We have things to do, people to see, places to go. We have children to raise. As we enter a new year filled with unknowns, resolutions, dares, and yes, a presidential election, let us remember that there are always people near that we can turn to. People near who are turning to us. If only we would remember to look up and look out and see the community that's just bursting to lend a talent or two. That's the only way that Jesus happens. Christ comes on a wave of hope and peace and joy and love and help. Maybe you're the visionary. Maybe you're not, but you are necessary. You are vital. Jesus comes when we choose to be him together, each in our own special way. And now as we look to the future, to the painful, heaving work that lies ahead in the stories of adult Jesus, and in the year 2024, let us remember, it takes a village to raise a child. May it be so. Amen. Thank you. as Mary's son. We cannot keep the Savior there, for Christ is meant for everywhere, not just for shepherds' watchful eyes, nor for the Magi's valued prize. As God's own person here on earth, Christ came to show us human worth. So Jesus cannot stay a child, dependent, gentle, meek, and mild. The carpenter of Galilee must leave his home and shop as he takes up the mission and the pain of life and death and life again. So gladly let us sing and pray, since Christ is born for us each day, and Christ is risen with God to reign. Let earth repeat the glad refrain. Glory to God in depth and height, alleluia from dawn to night. All space and time in Christ rejoice, in praise to God a single voice.
Amen. Thank you, J. Kyle, for that reminder of our call as a community. As a community to be church together. And part of being church together is, of course, sharing what's on our hearts, being vulnerable and present with God and with each other, talking about what's going on in our lives. Friends, what are the prayers of concern and sorrow for our own lives and for the world? Pat.
I mentioned my brother-in-law, Bill, last week. They decided to make one more fight against the infection in his leg. It didn't work, so today he's being released to hospice at home.
For Bill and for his family and friends during this time, I pray. Other prayers?
A prayer of both concern for her family, but actually also prayer of thanks for the life of my good friend Nancy, who died this morning. She was a lawyer and a good one. She had a sharp mind and a sharp tongue that was mostly moderated by her great sense of humor. But she did wonderful things for her family and big circle of friends, for Nancy.
For Nancy and all those who are missing her today, I pray.
Yeah, for our friend Holly, who lost her unborn baby about the first trimester. She was so excited to be pregnant after trying for so long. So prayers for Holly, I pray.
Join our hearts in prayer.
My technician, the nurse, the equivalent of a nurse in my field, has been out with back surgeries times three since August. And she returns on Tuesday, coming back to work with less pain, but I'm worried for her that this is going to be a hard recovery. So for Jana.
Jana? For Jana, I pray.
For my grandma who broke her back. For my grandma who broke her back in a car accident.
For Emmett's grandma and her healing, I pray. Other prayers that have words yet? Let's continue in a spirit of prayer. Holy One, we lift up to you all of these prayers on our hearts, the ones that find words and the ones that are floating around in the space between our hearts and our lips, not yet finding form. God, you know us inside and out, our comings and our goings, our grief. God, you know how deeply this world needs your presence, needs Christ, needs Emmanuel, God with us. The season of Advent is over, and we are fast hurtling through Christmas to Epiphany. God, we pray that your light would shine, that the world would become aware of the opportunity to choose you, to choose community, to choose healing, to choose abundance. God, for those in this community around us, Seattle, Washington, who don't have what they need. For those in this global community all around your earth who are lacking food, water, shelter, and peace. For all those who are enduring bombardment and barricades and threats. And for those with power to lift those threats, to tear down walls, to build peace, and yet who find themselves feeling constrained by political forces beyond their control. God, we pray that you would send your spirit into those places to bring in a time of abundance and peace, that your spirit would wash over our hands and into our lungs, compelling us with your power, with your love, to be your hands and feet in this world. And God, we thank you for all the ways that you remind us of your presence, for moments of consolation, community in the midst of grief, and especially for moments of joy and celebration. Friends, let's remember some of those moments of joy, some of those celebrations right now, and lift them up to God. What prayers of joy are there here today? Jan was ready for that one.
This is a little bit of a joy and concern. A longtime friend, Marcia, finally got insurance okay for a stent to be put in her heart. She's had to, you know, bear the drugs first before the insurance will do it. So Marcia is supposed to have the heart stent on Friday. So prayer and joy that this will happen.
For Marcia's family and for her care team, I pray. And for the process of insurance allowing this to happen, I give thanks to God. Other prayers of joy.
I have a joy this morning. 10 years ago tonight, Dustin and I realized that we were in love. And 9 years ago tonight, we got married. And I just am thankful and joyful for 9 years of marriage to a wonderful man who takes very good care of me.
for 9 years of joyful marriage and partnership. I give thanks to God.
Well, on Thursday, I got my left eye fixed. It was a bit of a non-event because I don't remember any of it. I just woke up and somebody had cleaned the windshield, and it works. So.
Your eyes. For Elizabeth and her eye, I give thanks to God.
Yeah, for Jay Kyle being with us in that marvelous message this morning. So for the presence of Jay Kyle, I give thanks. For the best Christmas I've had since I was a little kid.
For a wonderful Christmas, I give thanks to God.
Last Saturday night, the pastor of, I believe, a Lutheran church in Bethlehem gave an absolutely stunning sermon, Christmas message, where he called out all of the political systems that are and the non-support for the people of Gaza and the political system supporting the Gazan destruction. It was an amazing sermon, and so I'm thankful for the guts he had to do that. It's the same church that had the pile of rubble in the corner with the infant Jesus on that. That was their nativity scene. But it was an amazing sermon, and search for it on YouTube if you'd like. But I was very thankful to listen to that, and thankful for someone right in the middle of it to make the statements that he made.
For powerful and prophetic sermons arising from these corners of our world that are so close to suffering, I give thanks to God.
For Jay Kyle's abilities and music abilities and what he's brought to the church, and for the sermon this morning, I'd like to thank him.
For Jay Kyle and the gifts that he shares as he leads us in music and worship, I give thanks to God. Other prayers? If there are not other prayers, then let's continue in prayer using the prayer that Christ taught us as printed in our bulletin. Our Creator in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Now, in a moment here, a plate is going to go by. And as the choir is singing and Jay Kyle is playing and you are listening, the plate will be presented in front of you. And whether you're putting something in it, I want to invite you to reach out and touch it. Maybe hold it for a second. If you're joining us remotely, I want to invite you to raise or reach out with your hand or use the raise hand button. That's because all of us, all of our contributions, not just our cash, not just our money, not just our treasure, but our time, our talent, our presence, the opportunity for the Spirit to move from one of us to the other is what makes up this church. It's what sustains this ministry here in this place. And all of you are a part of that. Friends, as we have been given, let us freely offer back to God. Amen. Thank you. with words, music, acts of service, prayer. We offer our gifts to you, Holy One. We pray that you would take each gift and every giver, that you would use them, that you would bless them, that they would be part of the building up of your kingdom. Amen. Now, part of sharing our time, our talents, our treasure, part of being the body together and here in this place, is when we have things going on, things happening in the church, that we make sure to tell each other about it. So if you have an announcement, I want to invite you to come up and I guess cue behind Tom. Tom, why don't you take us away?
Just a note that we have our first monthly breakfast of the year coming up this Saturday at the Bay Cafe. So everybody's welcome. We meet at 8 o'clock and it's a great time of fellowship and to get together.
In a couple weeks, January 15th is Martin Luther King Jr. Day, and there's a march in Seattle for that. It's an annual event. There's a whole week of activities. We'll put some announcements in the weekly bulletin about all the activities. It'll be a link to a website. But I'm planning on going to the march. I think Dave is. I don't think we'll do an organized WPPC representation and trip over. It starts at Garfield High School. But if you're interested, let us know and we can seek each other out when we're there. It starts, I think, at 12:30 on Monday, January 15th, MLK Day.
I'm doing this for Jean, I guess. For Wednesday is our membership meeting and the meal. If you are feeling like eating on Zoom with us at 6 o'clock on Wednesday, and then please stay for the meeting for membership.
And if there are no further announcements, Todd, would you grab that board back there with the cloth on it? I want to invite our youngest members to come up and join me up here. Terrific, thank you.
We do.
All right. Okay, it's not my role, but I just remembered that we need to announce a congregational meeting like 2 weeks in advance. So there's going to be a congregational meeting right after church on January 14th, mostly to talk about the budget, how we did this year, and what we've budgeted for next year.
Well, so there'll be two items on the agenda. One will be that presentation of the budget, how it did, what's happening with the budget next year, which is not a vote, it's an informing. But the second item on the agenda, which will be a vote, is changing terms of call for the pastor, which would be this guy. We'll be changing our pastor situation there. So please try to remember to be here on the 14th. Now, August, Elliot, you guys are old hands at this, right? You've been here before? Elliot, can you tell us what we're doing here?
Bab.
Pretty close. So we're here celebrating communion, and at this piano bench, which we've covered with a tablecloth and made into a table, we remember a different table. We remember a table that Jesus gathered around with his friends to celebrate a meal. And at that table were all kinds of people, just like there are all kinds of people here. Now, who's welcome at this table? I wonder if a Brassfield can tell me. August, can you tell me who's welcome at this table? This is a very, very quiet everyone. Friends, all of us are welcome here. Christ's covenant, the covenant that's made and shared at this table, is for everyone. And so all of you who would share in what Christ is doing in that moment, in our lives today, this table is for you. And so with assurance that all are welcome, we say to one another, God be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to our loving God. So at that meal that he was sharing with his friends, they had simple food, bread and wine. And he took that bread and he said to them, this is my body broken for you. When you eat this, remember me. And he took it and he broke it. That's good enough. You want to hold that up? In the same way, when the meal was over, he took the cup and poured it out. Thank you for the help. And he held it out to them, saying, this cup is the promise of the covenant. It's a new covenant and sealed in my blood, but it's for you. As often as you drink this, remember me. Will you guys pray with me? Will all of you pray with me too? Send, O God, your Holy Spirit upon this bread and upon this cup, that all who share in it might be the body of Christ, might be light, life, and love in the world. In this hope that we would be your people, we praise you and we bless you. Amen. Thanks, boys. Friends, come. The table is set. The meal is ready. Come. Thank you.
All right, it's time for our last carol sing of the season. We've got, looks like, six more requests here. So let's begin with number 30, Born in the Night, Mary's Child. Go ahead and stand up. Born in the night, Mary's child, a long way from your home. Coming in need, Mary's child, born in a borrowed room. Verse 5, hope of the skip forward to number 46. There we are. On this day, thank you. 66. Friends, as we leave this place today, let us remember to look up and look out at the community around us. Remember that we have an opportunity, a responsibility to do our part to make Jesus come alive in the world around us. Go in peace and in the spirit of help and leaning on one another, because that's when Jesus comes and brings us joy. Amen.
Thank you. If you are our host, for this event. Thank you for making it possible for us to Zoom on in.